Yeah. I was asked the other day, say, you a Muslim? I said, no. Said, you a Christian? I said, well, I believe in God, but I play golf on Saturdays and Sundays. I don't go to church too much, you know. So my fight in this whole thing is neutral. What I'm all about is seeing Fresno become a better place. I'm after seeing young folks get off of crack. I'm after seeing young people get off of welfare. I'm about seeing this community bonded together like no other community in the nation. I've said that if the preachers and the people in Fresno got together, within 12 months' time, you wouldn't even know that you were in the same city. Last night, Minister Farrakhan said it was something about Fresno. Something. Minister Farrakhan was supposed to be catching a plane tomorrow, leaving because he's got to be in Washington, D.C. He's altered his schedule to be here another day because it's something about Fresno. I don't know whether it's the air or the people or what, but he loves the people that he saw. He has been treated nice since he's been here. I hope you will extend that invitation to him to treat him nice. You didn't come here to hear me. You come to hear the man that's going to shake this house down tonight. May I proudly present the Honorable Louis Farrakhan.
You too. In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, the one God to whom all praise is due, the Lord of the worlds, Allah, the Creator of all things, Allah, the Revealer of all truth, Allah, the Sender of all prophets. We thank him for Moses and the Torah. We thank him for Jesus and the Gospel. We thank him for Muhammad and the Quran. Peace be upon all of these worthy servants of God. If I lived to be 1,000, I could never thank Allah enough for his intervention in our affairs. In the person of Master Farad Muhammad, the great Mahdi. I thank the Mahdi, Master Farad Muhammad, for searching among us till he found one worthy and able to carry a message that would raise black people up from a level of mental death and ignorance to the heights of civilized behavior. He found one in the person of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, the man who taught me what I know, the man who gave me the example of strength and dignity and righteousness that I hope one day I will be able to attain. I'm speaking of his messenger to us, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. I greet all of you, my dear brothers and sisters, with the greeting words of peace. We say it in the Arabic language, Assalamu alaikum. But it means in English, peace be unto you. To Brother Nellums, to the board and members of the NAACP, to Minister Larry, to the Muslim community who follow the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and to the Orthodox Muslim community, to our Christian clergy and brothers and sisters, and to the members of the Jewish community who are present, to the Chicano, La Raza, or Hispanic community who are present, to the members of the press, and to the dignified rostrum of ministers of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and community leaders. It is a great honor and privilege for me to be here tonight in Fresno. The greeting word of the Muslim, which is the greeting word of the Jews, which is the greeting word of all civilized people, Shalom or Salam, peace. Peace is the way of the righteous. Peace is that which the nations seek but are unable to find. Peace is the desire of every human being who understands that without peace and contentment of mind, there is no heaven on earth for any human being. But how is peace attained? We can make peace with the social order by submission to the power of that social order. We can make peace on our jobs by being obedient to those in authority over us. But peace with God is the true peace. And peace with God can never be attained until we submit our will to do the will of God. When we enter into peace with God, then a whole system of law and value flows from recognition of God. Then when I am at peace with God, then I should be at peace with my fellow man. If for some reason I am not at peace with my fellow man, but am at peace with God, then there's something wrong with my fellow man that needs to be corrected, because God would not grant me the greatest of all gifts, which is His peace, if I am not in obedience to His will. You are looking at the most vilified black man in the history of America. I don't think there ever has been a brother or a black man that has sustained such a withering attack on his character and reputation as Louis Farrakhan. But I want you to look at me. I am 60 years of age. I have been married to the same woman for 40 years. I have 9 children, 23 grandchildren, and 1 great-grandchild. I have never been arrested in my life. I have no criminal record.
Yes, sir.
If you dig into my past, I have no friends in the past that will tell you anything evil of me. Yet I have been depicted as a modern Hitler.
Yes, sir.
I have been depicted as a hater, as a violent man, as a man who would disrupt human relationships. I have been depicted as a man that good Christian people should have nothing to do with, and good Muslims should condemn. But here before you is a man that does not drink, does not smoke reefer or cigarettes, uses no drugs, chases no women nor men. Look at me. Have you ever seen a 60-year-old man more beautiful in your life? Oh, Farrakhan, you should be ashamed of yourself to speak like that. What I'm trying to suggest to you is you don't see any furrow on my brow that I'm worried about the arrow that comes by day or the one that flies by night, for I am shadowed under the wings of the Almighty. I'm not afraid for my life, for yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, there is no fear of evil, for a greater power than the powers that are against me are with me. I have no problem sleeping at night, because to the best of my knowledge, I have done no man wrong. So if I am at peace with God, and God is pleased with me, that he favors me above you who condemn me, that no matter how much you beat on me, God puts love in the people's hearts for me, and I've never met them before, then who am I that I have not found favor with you, but I have found favor with God? The government of America does not like me. The CIA and the FBI does not like me. Some members of the Christian community don't like me. Some members of the Jewish community don't like me. Some members of the Orthodox Muslim community don't like me. But nobody has been able to stop my progress in this world. Said, if God be for you, who can be against you? So evidently, if the most powerful government on earth is against me and plots against me,
and a powerful people are against me and continually plot against me. The media is against me. Preachers, some of them are against me. But I continue to make progress toward the goal that God has assigned to me. Then you ought to stop and think now. That if God is for me, why aren't you? Those of you who hate me, what have I ever done to you that justifies your hatred of your brother? The scripture says of Jesus, they hated him without a cause. You have no justified reason to hate Farrakhan. I never put a swastika on a synagogue. I never overturned a Jewish gravestone. I've never harmed the hair on the head of one Jewish old man, woman, or child. I have respect for the Torah and all the prophets of Israel. I have respect for the synagogue as a house where God's word is remembered. But I must speak against evil. I don't care who does it. So I don't intend to make peace with the social order or with those in political power. I have made peace with God, and that is sufficient for me. For if America's social order is unjust, if America's political order is corrupt, if America's religious house is full of corruption, if America's streets are unsafe, then how can I, who have made peace with God, laid down with this order? I must speak against it with truth. Yes, sir. That America may correct herself. Yes, sir. And come into favor with God. Amen. And if it pleases God that I die speaking the truth, yes, I am no better than those that went before me. Yes, but I don't believe that it pleases God for such to happen. And therefore, whether you like me or not, you're gonna have to deal with me sooner or later. I will never sell out the cause of freedom, justice, and equality for my people. By the grace of God, you can count on that. All right. But I am growing more and more every day to feel not only the pain of my own people, all right, but to feel the pain of all who are oppressed. Therefore, if our Hispanic or Chicano or La Raza brothers and sisters don't have a voice, I will speak on their behalf. If the Native Americans don't have a voice, I will speak on their behalf. If the poor of America, black and white, don't have a voice, I will speak on their behalf, because America is wrong and America must be made right. And America will never be made right unless somebody is strong enough and bold enough to stand up and tell the truth. America is suffering. And from my vantage point, America lies on her deathbed, in dire need of guidance and a new direction. The nerve of those who say This is a pluralistic society. The nerve of those who say, this is a multicultural society, and Farrakhan, you don't have any place in that kind of society. What hypocrisy. What hypocrisy. America was never founded for Arabs or Mexicans or Native Americans, certainly not for black, and it never was founded for Asians. When the founding fathers said, we the people, they did not have you and me in mind. In fact, they never had poor white people in mind. We the people. When they said that, my fathers were in chattel slavery. When they said that and formed the Constitution, we were three-fifths of a human being. Or have you forgotten?
Go ahead.
The founding fathers never saw an America with millions of Hispanic people. The founding fathers never saw the time that black people would be free. And in Congress, senators, governors, and maybe one day running the country, the founding fathers never saw that. The founding fathers never saw Asians coming to the western coast of America with strength and power to buy up hotels and land and agricultural economy. They never saw the rise of Asia.
All right.
They never saw the rise of Mexico to the south or the rise of Africa. They saw America as by white people for white people and of white people forever. Forever. And so they set up a religious system that spoke to white value, not divine value, but white racist supremacist value. Talk back to me. The Native American never had the Torah. The Native American never had the gospel. How dare you think that this people never had truth because they never had your Torah or your gospel. The Quran says Allah has raised among every nation a messenger. Some of us don't need your Torah or your gospel to know God.
Yes, right. Yes, sir.
Or your Quran. These books are roadmaps for those who got lost from the path of God, that they may be guided back to a path that they had lost. If you were in the natural way of the natural people, you would not need a scripture to guide you back. Y'all all right?
Yes,
so am I. I'm just getting warmed up. I'm sorry about the preachers who didn't make it tonight. I'm going to be at church tomorrow, Reverend. I don't think there's a reverend out here that can preach Jesus better than me. And if you doubt it, come to the bishop's church tomorrow. You should be ashamed of yourself.
Right.
Let me go on. Since the founding fathers did not ever envision 40 or more million of us and growing, 20 or more million Hispanics and growing, a growing number of Asians, then the whole educational, political, and social system, as well as religion, is based on Eurocentric values. Eurocentricity. Then don't tell me about multicultural values unless you change from a Eurocentric position to embrace the peoples of America. Did I say something wrong? See, you can't play the game of multiculturalism when somebody is awake and alert.
That's right.
And knows the truth.
Yes, sir. That's right.
But I will expose your hypocrisy.
Yes, sir.
Your lying, deceitful way that all of the little people won't be tricked anymore.
That's right.
By government, by religion, by politics, or by a corrupt social and economic order. And that's what makes Farrakhan dangerous. Because he's not under the control of those who control our leaders. If we examine America's vital signs, we will come to agree that these vital signs show that America is steadily on the decline. And if something is not done, America will enter the 21st century, not a superpower, but a super loser, after having been at the head of the nations of the earth. You will lose your position. Why? The root of America's suffering is a basic immorality and vanity, where greed, lust, and an inordinate self-interest has become the way of life. People have taken their own personal desires and put them above the desire of family, the desire of community, and the desire of a nation. People have taken party and put it above the best interests of a nation. So if something good is coming from the Democratic Party because it didn't come from the Republicans, they will fight it. So this gridlock keeps America from moving forward. The leaders in the society, in their struggle to achieve their inordinate self-interest, engage in hiding the light of truth from the American people. And without truth, the American people are left paralyzed, unable to constructively address their problems. Colleges everywhere, students going in debt to pay for an education that becomes useless. If I were a used car salesman and sold you an automobile that looked real good, but there was no motor in it, you could sit in it, roll the window down, and look like you're going someplace.
I might even give you a key and tell you it works.
But if you're unable to drive the car off the lot, then I'm guilty of perpetrating a fraud.
Yes, that's right.
To invite you to come to college, where your mothers and fathers have to scrub floors and work hard to give you an education that they were unable to achieve, and then to have you come out with a degree that you can't use.
Amen.
That is perpetrating a fraud.
And if America and you that pass out the degrees, if you are wise enough, then answer this question for me. You teach economy. You teach economics. You teach banking and finance. America is $4 trillion in debt. The current budget for federal spending is $1.5 trillion. Yet only a little over $1 trillion comes in from federal income tax, which leaves a $500 billion tax deficit each year. The interest alone in servicing the federal debt soared to $288 billion in 1991, which is approximately one-third of what America took in taxes. Think about this. A third of what America took in taxes, which is $1 trillion, had to be paid to service the $4 trillion debt, which is continuing to rise. If President Clinton is not able to cut the debt, and if the tax revenue remains the same at the end of 4 years of President Clinton's presidency, America will be nearly $7 trillion in debt, more than the gross national product, and it will take just about everything that comes in taxes to service the debt of the country, so the country 4 years from now could be bankrupt.
Yeah. This is why they're cutting back on programs now. And you, black people, who need so much, the inner cities of America need so much, the infrastructure needs so much, but America has to think of what the priorities are. So with the collapse of the Soviet Union, America feels it's more important to prop up the Soviet Union than to prop up the infrastructure of the country and to look out for the masses of the American people. America is borrowing from the pension funds. She's borrowing from Social Security to pay some of the debt. So some of you that are working, thinking that when you get to be 65 and retire, you'll have some money there. Wouldn't it be something when you think you have something, that they tell you, I'm sorry. Oh, America, you mighty teachers of economics, why don't you solve that problem? You want to give out a master degree and a doctorate degree in economics, but you can't balance your own budget. You got garbage going from port to port because you don't know what to do with your own garbage. You're making a mess and don't know what to do with it. How in the hell can you teach economics to anybody? You have spent the taxpayers' dollars developing nuclear weapons, and now you want a nuclear-free society. So what did you spend the money for? Now you have to dismantle what you spent billions of dollars for. You have nuclear waste now that you're burying that's poisoning the water table, poisoning the earth, poisoning the atmosphere. And this is what you call leadership. You have voted these people into office. I tell you, brothers and sisters, it's time in America for a change. Not a change of political party, but a change in the mentality of those who govern you. It's sad. They want to make the American people believe that this is a country for the people. Oh, really? For what people? Oh, I know this hurts. But it helps more than it hurts. In 1989, the top 4%, 3.8 million individuals and families, earned $452 billion in wages and salaries, the same as the bottom 51%, or 49.2 million individuals. I'm going to say that again. Yes, sir. 4%, 3.8 million individuals earned $452 billion in wages and salaries, the same as 51%. 49.2 million individuals and families. So who is benefiting from the vast wealth of America? It's not the poor. It's not really the middle class. It is a small group of people who are sucking the blood of the masses of the American people. Millions of workers have been displaced by plant closings and relocations to foreign markets, such as Mexico, where labor costs are a fraction of U.S. labor costs. Since 1980, over 2 million manufacturing jobs have vanished in America, while at the same time the adult population has risen by 11%. What does this mean, Farrakhan? It means that as the population expands and the job market decreases, you have more people fighting age and working age that are out of employment. if there is no more threat of nuclear war with Russia, and over 150,000 troops that were paid by the United States government are now brought back home with no jobs. Military bases closing. Are you listening? People trained how to kill, but nobody to kill. We don't have a Russian enemy anymore. Right. Trouble is in the house.
Yes, sir.
Deep trouble is in the house.
Yes.
You got these young people coming to school. You're teaching them sociology. You're teaching them psychology, professor. Look at the social fabric of America. How will your students be able to solve what you professors can't solve?
Yes, sir.
You're perpetrating a fraud.
Yes, yes, sir.
Brothers and sisters going to college to come out with a degree in African American studies. Try that in the marketplace. And you wonder why you don't have a job. Who's your teacher in psychology? Who's the writer of the book?
Well, we're studying Freud. We're studying Jung.
And the psychology that you have doesn't work with today's children. The children outthink their parents. At 18 months of age, they're running their parents crazy.
Reverend, my friend, church getting older. All the old folks jammed up in the church. Young folk jammed up in the streets. What does that tell you, Reverend? You're gonna die. The old folks in the church are gonna die. Well, where the young folk? You're not making a way for them. You Masons and Shriners, where are the young people? You're not making a way for them. You're getting old and dying in the folly of your rituals. But the young are in the street, and all your secret knowledge, you can't open a young man's mind. Somebody's perpetrating a fraud. Join my sorority, join my fraternity. There you'll find brotherhood. So my Masonic brothers and Eastern Star sisters, you have brotherhood. You do, huh? But the children in the street got gangs. And their gangs are stronger than your brotherhood. Because their gangs are driving your brotherhood crazy because you can't reach the children. Somebody's perpetrating a fraud.
Yes, sir. That's right.
You got 33 degrees of knowledge of a circle, but you can't use it to unlock the minds of those in your civilization. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught us that education is the torchlight of civilization.
Yes, sir.
But now you have an educational system that's in decline. From 10 to 30% of those who graduate from America's high schools graduate as functional illiterates. The first words that the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, heard, the word Iqra, read. Read in the name of thy Lord who creates man from a clot and taught man by the pen what man knew not. Read. And thy Lord is most generous. And you have everything that you could ever want to learn today is found somewhere in a book. And you got 30% of your people unable to read. Not even unable to read, but doesn't even have a desire to learn to read. So you're the slave of a media that is controlling your life by the images that they put on a screen in a 30-second bite. Somebody is perpetrating a fraud. Oh, America, you're losing steadily. Your country is being taken from you. And you're so dumb, your head is in your crotch. You can't even see that your country is gone because you're too busy chasing crotch. Go print that. The crotch chasers. You, the masses of the American people, are being subdued, and you don't even realize that you've been taken over already. America makes you think you have the freedom of choice, but you are like sheep and you have been herded in a direction that is not in the best interest of yourself or the nation or the future of the world. The world is to be controlled by a handful of wise satanic beings. This is why Farrakhan is hated. Because I'm challenging the satanic powers that are dominating America. In the Quran, which is the book of scripture of Muslims, Shaitan or Satan means one whose evil is not confined to self, but ill affects others. Satan, the Bible calls him the arch deceiver. He's hidden from the public view. So Paul says, we war not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and the rulers of the darkness of this world and spiritual wickedness that's in high places. And until somebody can climb up into the high places and call out these forces, then the people who are on a lower level of knowledge and understanding will always be the victim of these unseen powers. But Farrakhan sees the unseen powers. In the book of Thessalonians, it says, that day shall not come. What day? The day of judgment. That day shall not come except there be a falling away first. and the man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. Who is the man of sin? It didn't say the spirit of sin, it said the man of sin. Somebody is leading the world into madness and is unseen and must be uncovered. And whether you like it or not, it's my job to uncover this man of sin. In the Bible, there was a woman who was possessed of devils. And when Jesus met the woman, he started calling the devils up out of the woman. The devils were hiding in the woman. This is a terrible thing to put on a woman. I'll explain it in a minute. Dear females, don't get upset. There's more devils in these men than could ever be found in you. If it were not for the woman, the nations of the world would have no hope at all. God gave woman to man to balance him. And what man has done is shut woman out so that he has no balance. And that's why he's tearing his world apart and taking you down with him. But we're going to expose it all because somebody is perpetrating a fraud. Now, where was I? Oh, yeah, the devils were coming out of the woman. And as the devils were coming out of the woman, the devils were very angry. And they were kind of getting on Jesus. And the devil said to Jesus, but they were coming out, though. They said, why are you persecuting us before time? See, Satan knows that there's a time set for him. Satan knows that he had a certain time to deceive the peoples of the earth. But he also knew that one was coming to make him manifest,
yes, sir. Amen.
And to pull the people away from Satan,
yes,
that they might be saved, that Satan may go down,
all right,
but not take the righteous down with him.
All right, sir.
So the Satan, the devils were coming out of the woman and cussing Jesus. Their calendar had been messed up, so they weren't quite aware of the time. But Jesus was on time. Now, the Holy Quran puts it like this. God and the devil had a conversation. And the devil says to God, I'm going to come after them in thy straight path.
All right.
Muslims, in sirat al mustaqim, in the straight path of God, Satan says, that's where I'm gonna be.
Right.
Uh-oh. I want you to listen to me good now. He says, I'm gonna come after them, meaning the righteous. From before them, from behind them, from their left side, from their right side, and you won't find most of them thankful. I'm going to make all of them deviate. I know you think because you're a Christian or a Jew or a Muslim or you have some religious belief, I know you think you're in the straight path of God. How could you be in the straight path and crooked? Somebody's perpetrating a fraud. Here we are saying we're on the straight path of God and don't know what sex we are. Somebody's perpetrating a fraud, y'all. Liars and thieves in the house of God. Whoremongers, adulterers in the house of God. Homosexuals in the house of God. Yet God condemns all errant behavior. Huh?
Yes, sir.
But evil has been made fair seeming. So you don't even see yourselves as being off the path of God. You see yourself as all right. Somebody has perpetrated a fraud. But evil has been made fair seeming. So you don't even see yourselves as being off the path of God. You see yourself as all right. Somebody has perpetrated a fraud. They've come right in the path of God and caused the people of God to deviate. And they don't even know they're as far off from the straight path as the far distant planet Pluto is from the earth, from the sun, and that's 4,600,000,000 miles away. Before I got to Fresno, my friends in the media, my friends, I call them my friends. Because they don't really know how friendly they have been. Thank you so much for filling the house. You talk so bad about Farrakhan. People wondered, you know, who is this man that you all got so frightened? We better cough up that $25 and find out who this man is. So I call them my friends because they don't even know they're working for God today. That's why I'm so at peace. I really don't care what you say about me. Because if I thought I were what you paint me to be, I'd run and hide. But when I read the stuff you write, I really have, it really lifts my spirit. The cartoons that you put in the paper of me, they're so terrific. I'm going to devote a whole room in my house, this is the truth, to the cartoon so that when I get low in spirit, I just get a chair and laugh myself into feeling good again. I really think I understand what Jesus meant. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice. I mean, it's hard to rejoice when people are beating the hell out of you, you know? But I guess, you know, fire has its purpose. It purifies gold. Thank you so much. I say to my friends in the media, you know, in truth, the deceit that is practiced, you don't know me. You went in front of me to make my path difficult, just like the book says you would do. You weren't inspired by God to do this. You were inspired by Satan. I'll point him out in a minute.
Yes.
You can't wait till I leave because you're going to come behind me. I read in the paper today the beautiful, I think it's a 7-point program that the Christians and the Jews have gotten together for your benefit. Well, I'm glad if I can stimulate those who didn't do a damn thing for you at no other time. To now come forward. We're going to answer Farrakhan. Yeah, when I'm gone, I ask to meet with you. Because if you have something, I really want to hear it. But you took a vote. You don't even want to meet with me. What hypocrites? These are Christians who love everybody. You mean you love everybody and don't have a little space in your heart for poor little old me? It's so pitiful. These are people that love everybody. Why won't you meet with me? Because you really hate me. For what? I didn't lynch you. I didn't burn you at stake. I didn't rape your black mother so you could come out a mulatto. Educate you. I didn't send you to war to fight for a freedom that you still don't have. That's done by the people you want to sit down and sup with and have tea with. I'm a brother that's trying to clean up the mess that white folk have made, and you don't want to sit down with me. Drugs in the black community. I didn't sell guns to your children. I didn't didn't set up an educational system to teach you how to hate your black self. I didn't make mockery of the thickness of your lips and the broadness of your nose and the kinkiness of your hair. The people you want to snuggle up next to are the people that did that. But you don't want to talk to me. Well, to the demons that went in front and to the demons that come behind and to the demons that will come at my right to pose as my friends and to the demons that will come from the left to be an outright enemy, I'm on time. And that's why you're screaming. As you're coming up out of the people, I hear you crying out. Why are you persecuting us before it's time? It is time, and I'm on time. And so the American people, the masses, are suffering for the lack of knowledge. Hosea says, my people are destroyed for the lack of knowledge. They've pitted us against our Hispanic brothers and sisters. And now the blacks and the Mexicans, who should be in an alliance with each other, are at odds with each other. The Mexican people, as they are called, are the original people. They're mixed with the blood of their conquerors, as we are. But they are a part of the original inhabitants of the Western Hemisphere.
All right.
And if you're a student of the culture of the native people, and you look at their art, and you look at their crafts, and you look at the arts and the crafts of our kith and kin in Africa, sometimes you can't tell the difference between Native American art and African art. Do you know why? Because we're related. Down in Mexico, you have some huge heads of thick lip, broad nose, black people, to let you know that before Columbus came, we were here. And at the root of the culture of Olmec culture is a tie to Africa. We are a family that has been separated by time and different masters. But time again says that the black and the brown and the red must recognize their root. Even though the branch may be looking different, at the root, they are one.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
So we must build bridges of understanding to the oppressed peoples. I saw a Newsweek article some years ago in which the demographers, the students of population growth, said that the white population growth is approaching zero population growth, which means for every birth of a white, there's the death, so that their population remains somewhat constant. But no matter what disease is in the black and the brown, and no matter how much they have sterilized the Native American women, yet they say that the population by the year 2086, if it is unabated on the black side, that black population will either be equal to the white or superior in less than 100 years. Listen. So when you hear a racist that has no idea of a multicultural society, a racist who believes that America is by white people, for white people, and of white people perpetually, then that kind of mind says we must do something to keep the black and the brown and the red from uniting. We must do something to keep the black and the brown and the red from populating. We must do something to turn them in on themselves so that they will be the architects of their own self-destruction. Somebody is perpetrating a fraud around here. It's not an accident that AIDS is moving among the black more than anybody else. You crotch watchers. Your crotch is being used now for your destruction. I feel sorry for poor white people, poor black people, poor brown and red people. Why, Farrakhan? Why? Because every human being has been given a gift from the divine creator. There's not one in this audience who is not my superior, and there's not one in this audience, in some respect, I am their superior. Because what God gave you, he may not have given to me, and what he gave me, he may not have given to you, but your gift and my gift, they're equal, and you must evolve and develop your gift so that you will never be envious or jealous of the gift of another. I want you to hang with me for a while. You're not tired, are you? I want to talk about envy for a minute, because that's a great problem among us. You know, if we see the Mexican moving out, we get envious. If we see a member of our own community or family get a benefit, it produces envy. Envy is the most irredeemable characteristic in human nature. It makes the possessor of it a devil. When you envy, it grows to hatred. And hatred makes it easy to murder one whom you are envious of. Why do you envy? Because you think somebody has something that you feel you have a greater right to than the person who possesses it. So when you're envious, your hatred is not just against the person whom you envy, but your envy has made you a hater of God, who is the giver of gifts. Listen carefully now. When you have a society that makes you think that high education belongs only to a certain class of people, somebody will tell you, oh no, college is not for you. You're not smart enough, you know. You should be a plumber. There's nothing wrong with being a plumber, because it takes great skill to be a good one. But there's something wrong in a society that sets up class by making human beings think that they are not qualified to master education. There's not one of you who is an animal unless you choose to be. But there is not one of you that cannot master any field of knowledge that you desire to master. Wait a minute. There's not one human being so handicapped that he cannot or she cannot become a master. How do you know that? If the scripture is a lie, then we ought to throw it away. But if I am made in the image and the likeness of God, who is master of all disciplines, then I am born to be a master. It's in my genetic makeup, since I am like you from God. Then the only thing that stunts my growth is an environmental situation over which I do not have control, that begins to feed my mind with false ideas and concepts that cripples my growth into mastery. Somebody's perpetrating a fraud. I have not met a man who is not my master in some way. Not one. And that's why I respect every human being, every child. I look at the little ones and I see greatness in them. And I understand why Jesus said, "Suffer the little children to come unto me, for of such is the kingdom of God." I understand, brothers and sisters, because I am a gifted brother of tremendous proportion. I mean, tremendous. But that never makes me feel like I'm more than any one of you. Amen. Because I know that in each one of you, amen, is a superior gift. Amen. And it is your duty to find your purpose in life. Right. To find your gift and let that gift evolve so that you can see why you should love you and not want to be anybody else but the you that God made. Yes, sir. one of you, black, brown, red, yellow, white, Jew, Gentile, Christian, Muslim, Buddhist, Hindu, Baptist, Republican, Democrat,
you are unique, matchless, and incomparable. You are a demonstration of the infinite wisdom of the Creator, who never made two snowflakes alike, two raindrops alike, never made two fingerprints alike, never made two human beings alike. There never was one like you before, and there never shall be one like you again. So each one of you should discover why you are here and we are here at this moment in time. This is our moment. We will never get it again. And our uniqueness will never be again. This is our time. Why then should we waste this precious time? Go ahead. Envying one another for our gifts rather than praising God for one another and helping to create an environment that each human being's gifts can be manifested, evolved, and developed. For in that, we glorify the Creator. And everywhere I look, I see His majesty, not only in the sky and in the planets and in the stars and in the sea and the wind and the mountains and the beauty of the flowers, but I see His majesty in its magnificent dimension in each human being that I have the pleasure of meeting. So when you shake my hand and say, "It's a pleasure to meet you, Brother Farrakhan," I say, "It's my honor, sir, to meet you." And you say, "What's wrong with him?"
All right.
It's because I know how great you really are. And I am sad that a world has been set up that is so unjust, all right, to those who live in it, that most human beings die like seeds that never germinate. And you die unfulfilled, never having known who you are.
Teach, Brother Minister.
That is a tragedy. But Satan's world is like that. This is not God's world. This is Satan's world. And he makes it seem as though just a few of us can achieve anything. And the rest of us are stupid. The rest are dumb. You're like cattle to be herded. And that is true. When my son was 10 years old, he asked me, "Dad, why is it in the scripture that Jesus is a man and the people are called sheep?" I said, "Son, I got to think on that one." He was 10. I went home and I thought on it, and I said, "Son, Jesus is given status in the scripture as a man because the force under which his life is placed had evolved and developed him fully, while the people to whom he was sent were underdeveloped and they were like sheep." Meaning that easy to be led in the wrong direction, hard to lead in a right direction. And this is why Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. Wait. If Jesus said, I am the good, why did he have to say that? Why didn't he say, I am the shepherd? Come on. He had to qualify his leadership. To show the contrast of Jesus' leadership from the wicked misleaders who were stunting the growth of human beings that were made in the image of God but could not develop and evolve into a manifestation of God, but were like animals, underdeveloped, with a college degree, but an animal in his head. A doctorate degree, but uncivilized in his behavior. Like sheep, herded, full of envy, strife, contention, looking at life in terms of material things. So the person who can come dragging minks across their shoulder with the latest style of shoes and coming out of a fine car, oh, that's Mr. So-and-so or Miss So-and-so. How we back up for dignitaries. Oh, here comes the heavyweight champion of the world. Look at how you act. As though you have nothing to offer. And here comes a great one. Oh, Farrakhan is coming. I'm coming to see you. Because you are greater than I am. And that's why it's easy to serve you. And it's easy to give my life for you. Because you are greater than I am. If you understand what I'm saying. Jesus was a good shepherd because he desired that the people not be enslaved to false leadership. He wanted each human being to know how to contact God so that you would never need a leader again. Amen. God himself would be your leader. Yes, sir. Oh, listen good now. The fraud is over. The fraud is over, baby. Satan got you so twisted up. You're looking for leaders. Child, we need a leader. You're not wrong. We do need one. But who? Yeah, all right. Well, I like Jesse myself, and well, I like John Jacobs. I like I like Farrakhan. Wait a minute. Who created you, Jesse? Farrakhan? NAACP? Urban League? Who created you? God. Who was with you in your mother's womb? Was it Jesse? Was it Farrakhan? Was it Martin Luther King? It wasn't. Ain't that something? It was just you in the womb, wasn't it? Yes, sir. You and who?
God.
God. Your mother didn't even know she was pregnant until 30 days after the fact. But the all-wise one knew when the sperm was emitted.
Amen. Go ahead.
He knew you.
All right.
In the womb.
Yeah.
And when the sperm met the egg and formed the first cell of life and needed a firm resting place, he allowed you and me to find a firm resting place in the womb.
Amen.
He evolved us from that stage to a clot, to an embryo, to a fetus, and brought us forth from the darkness of our mother's wombs at the appointed time. He gave our mothers a mammary gland in which would come nurturing, and that which would keep us away from disease just from sucking on her breast. He taught us how to suck. It's an instinctive motion of faith.
Go ahead. Go ahead. Teach on that.
Paul says, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things unseen. The baby didn't know that milk was there. Instinctively, it started sucking. And the sucking showed that the baby had faith that there was substance there, even though the evidence was yet unseen. But as the baby began to pull on the breast, something came from the breast that gave the baby immunity from disease. And milk came, and nurturing came, and depending upon the state of mind of the mother, the chemistry of her thoughts became the chemistry of her milk.
Yeah, yeah.
A mighty God was involved in every step of the way. So now that you're a grown person, who should be your leader? Which one of us is wise enough to be your leader?
All right.
And that's why David said, the Lord is my shepherd. I got a leader. He is my leader. I don't have to reach out for him. I reach up for him. If you understand the book, and I don't have time to go into it tonight, but Paul saw Jesus as a Christ figure, the indwelling manifestation of God.
Amen.
In a human being. David, the psalmist, says, ye are all God's children of the Most High God. Why haven't you manifested your godly qualities? It's because the environment is against your evolutionary development. You go to school and they cripple you. Children are real brilliant before going to school. In the first year of their lives, without an external teacher, they learn to crawl, they learn to stand up, they learn to walk. From just being. If you put them in the right environment and shape them properly, they will be a manifestation of God. But you send them to kindergarten, and kindergarten is two German words, das Kind, and Garten, K Kinder, meaning children, garden is a fertile and delightful spot for the planting of seeds. And since you don't know what seeds are being planted, and you wonder why your children grow up to be grapes of wrath rather than manifestations of divine growth, it's because the wrong seeds are planted. The seeds of racial superiority and racial inferiority in a so-called multicultural society are sown right there in the kindergarten. Dick and Jane. And don't forget Spot. We don't see a black relationship except the Spot on Spot. They got us kind of messed up, brother and sister. They show you a woman with long hair, and yours is not that long. Automatically, you begin to think something is wrong. Show you somebody with straight hair, you look in the mirror and... starts crippling you right away. You that are brown, or you that are red, or you that are black, they show you picture of Jesus, the greatest of all men. He's white, blonde hair, blue eyes, or maybe brown, Clairol. He changed his contact lenses. And after a while, you begin to look at your image. And you look so different from Jesus. And then the scripture said, when you see Jesus, you see the Father. For he's in the Father and the Father's in him. And you can't see yourself in Jesus, then you can't see yourself in the Father. You by shame now. Lord, why am I so black? And the blacker we are, the worse we feel. Because sometimes your own mother don't like you if you come out too dark. Talk back to me. Somebody perpetrating a fraud, brothers and sisters. Got you hating yourself. When if America were truly multicultural, you'd make every human being see themselves in the image of God. So that every human being would recognize that a bit of God is in them. But to make people think that God is white, and only white people are the manifestation of God, and all dark people are inferior because of their darkness, it sets you up, white folk, with a racist mentality that makes you feel somehow that you are above the law. And whatever you do to any dark person is all right because they ain't white. It ain't about law, it's not about justice, it's about whiteness.
Come on. All right.
A sick world,
yes, sir,
of classism, racism, and sexism are used to keep the people divided, and these three evils threaten to sink and destroy the entire country.
All right.
In a man's world, who is a woman? Who are you? What are you, woman? A plaything? Yes, you are. Not because God made you that. The world makes you that.
Amen.
And you play into it.
Yes, sir. All right.
The world makes you think that your value is 36, 26,
36. Amen. Big hips. Big butt. Big breasts. So strip yourself down, girl.
All right.
And let me see who you are. So you want us all to see you. So you make us to see you. You like us to see your breasts. Well, brothers, if you still immature, breast means a lot to you. Woman don't have time to put her baby on her breast, got this big grown man on her breast. Poor babies. Babies can't get to the feeding ground for the father. Mother dried up her milk. I ain't got time, baby. But this big goon, all over her breast. Look how silly you look.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
And your language reflects your lack of growth. Yeah. Come on over to my crib. What's a crib? Who sleeps in a crib? Ain't that right, baby? When are we gonna grow up? Little sheep? Pitiful. So sisters, the freak designers, they design your clothes so that men can't think constructively.
All right.
Mm-hmm. Show me your hips. You got things on so tight that if you sneeze, you are out of doors. God put our private parts in a place that they could easily be hidden.
Yeah.
In between the legs. But the jean designers make it so tight in the crotch that the sisters can see the brothers coming and measure them. And the brothers can see the sisters coming and their eyes immediately drop. They see the point. The crotch watchers. And how does it make you feel as a woman when you walk by and you know you fine? And a man's conversation stops. You see him turn. And then something low down comes out of his mouth. Do you know who you are, sister?
All right. Teach him. All right.
You are God's first creation. You're not the woman of man. You're the woman of God. The nature of you is such. You can't stay with a man that's not doing anything and not going any place. That's why there's so much divorce because nature makes you attracted to the opposite sex for the most part. And you get engrossed in each other sexually without ever asking, brother, where you going? Well, I'm going to your crib. I got some blocks in the crib. We gonna play. We gonna learn our colors. Satan has made a house full of fools. Grown men, grown women, men and women of so-called intelligence, and you're running around after each other's behinds. Like dogs. High intelligence. We've made our low desires a God beside God. Brothers and sisters, you need help. We need help. We're not evolving. We're not developing properly. Our growth toward God has been aborted. And Satan is happy. I remember when I was in show business, I used to sing calypsos. And I was on a television show many years ago, the Ernie Kovac show out of New York. And I had on these kind of shirts that have these ruffled sleeves, and it was cut down the center, and I had on these black pants that were tight, and I was working the midsection. You know how when you're playing Latin music, you understand, you know, it's the African tradition, you know. And the camera would only focus from here up because nearly 40 years ago, it was improper to show any sensuous movement on television. But today, here's a woman on television with just a string up her backside. If she got that on. On TV. Mother, you're busy. You're not watching. Satan has come in your living room. You went out and left your children in the hands of Satan as a babysitter. Now, wait a minute, Farrakhan. I mean, I only have the television in my living room. That's the point. Who's writing the scripts? Who's putting this foolishness together for you to watch and for your children to watch? All right. What are the subliminal ideas and suggestions in what you're watching? That's about that. And what effect is it having on the mind of you and your babies? You can tell what's going into your head by looking at what's coming out of your mouth and what is coming from your hands. You have become the most destructive generation. Look at you. There never was a generation of young people so violent as this generation. Never. And they are produced by you, mother and father. This is not a fruit that has fallen too far from the tree. Amen. I know, mother, dad, you think you're a good Christian. You're so far off, you don't even know. Sisters, hear me. Young girl gets pregnant. She didn't plan on that. It happened in a night of experimentation. Now she's pregnant. What can I do?
darling, you know, you're very young and you don't want to ruin your life. Your whole life is in front of you. But of course, abortion is legal. The state has made it so. Let's go have an abortion. That's what we'll do. So we go because we don't want our life ruined. We didn't mean to get pregnant. We were just experimenting with sex. And oh, what the hell? You know, it's not really alive. And so the abortionist in a clean-looking office takes the life from you, and you're free to go on with your life. And you don't feel nothing. I mean, they talk to you and counsel you a minute. You feel bad for a second. And then maybe your mother will say, you did the right thing, baby. You, a good Christian mother.
All right.
Shouting and running up and down the aisles and falling out with the Holy Ghost. But you tell your daughter, you did the right thing. Who's that man anyway? Damn it, stay away from men like that. So most of our young ladies, our young sisters in that position have already had an abortion.
All right.
They don't even sometimes have to tell any elder. That's criminal.
All right.
And something like that should go down with a young girl underage and the parents don't know nothing about it. You're taking away the rights of parents. Lord, look at the society. It's gone to hell.
All right.
And listen. Now, I don't want any sister in here who's had an abortion to feel bad. Let me just say this. You know, God forgives you for what you do in ignorance. But you are responsible once you know.
Right.
Now, as of tonight, anybody who has done that in this audience, don't worry about it. May God free your mind of that pain of guilt. And that's not what Farrakhan is about. But I want to show you something. Every human child is an answer to some prayer that somebody has prayed. Listen to me good. How many of you have had members of your family die from cancer? Would you raise your hand, please? How many of you right now have members of your family or friends who are suffering from cancer? Would you raise your hands, please? Wouldn't it be wonderful if a cure could be found for cancer? Where do you think the cure is going to come from? Dear sisters, dear women, it's going to come from your womb. Every savior, every deliverer, every scientist, every inventor, every one that has moved civilization forward has come from your womb. And whenever the nation needs something to advance it beyond a point where it is stagnated, a woman will give birth to a child that will advance human beings. So when you kill the fruit of your womb, you're killing the answer to your prayers. You don't even realize that the inconvenience to you as a young woman to have the child is what makes you destroy that life. Now, life is on the scene. 10, 11, 12, 13, 14.
Yeah.
and they are out there senselessly killing one another, and you ask, where did it come from? It came because you, as a mother, lost your sensitivity to human life. Amen. And now other women are burying their sons and their daughters because a generation has come up that has no sensitivity to the value of human life. As a man soweth, the same shall he also reap. And you are now reaping what you have sown, and a satanic government has opened the way for the destruction of human life because they fear the growth of black and brown and red human beings. Brothers and sisters, I'm nearing the conclusion. Death is covering the society. Government does not want strong leaders to arise among the Mexicans, among the Native Americans, and among the blacks. Government does not like strong leaders to even arise among the poor whites. You say this isn't a democracy. We have the right to vote. But then interest groups and PACs are robbing the American people of the value of your vote. And if anybody speaks out against what government is doing, they're anti-American. And if anybody speaks out against what government is doing, they're anti-American. Well, I've made a lot of criticisms tonight. Am I anti you? Do I hate you? Can't you feel that somebody really loves you? If I didn't love you, why would I bother to suffer what I am suffering? My life hangs in the balance. It ain't about money. Because I could make all the money that I wanted to with all the talent that I got.
And there would be a whole lot of people that would give me a lot of money if I would shut my mouth and go singing or playing my violin. Or... It's not about money. It's about human life. It's not about money. It's about human beings being free to grow and develop so that the earth may be made a better place for all of us to live on. It's not about money. It's about God, and it's about life and the value of your life. And so America is in deep trouble. There's no army outside of America that can destroy America. But America is dying as I speak because of an internal rot. There's no more standard of morality and decency, because the people don't know anymore what is right and what is wrong. So they take their own desires for their standard. I don't care. If I want it, it must be right. I'm in love with my brother's wife. And if loving you is wrong, I don't want to be right. Look how crazy we have become. There's no more standard of morality. I'll break into your house and steal your goods and don't feel bad about it. I see you with a new car and I don't have one. I'll just carjack you, and if you open your mouth, blow your life away for nothing. Right. Oh, Lord. Two young black men in Chicago. A young black brother and sister driving in a new Bronco. Pulled into a gas station. I'm sorry, three young black men. Saw them, put a gun on them, and drove them away into a wooded area of town. Took the young girl and raped her in front of the young boy.
All right.
And then shot her in her head. And then shot the brother in his head. And were joyriding around in the new Bronco.
Yeah. Amen.
Look how cold.
That's right.
How brutal.
Yes.
How vicious.
Yes.
We have become.
Yes.
Look at what has happened to you. And while you party and snap your fingers and pop and laugh at the foolishness that's put on television, low-life people with vile, filthy language, filthy jokes that you sit and laugh at because you've become swine.
All right. Make us
look. You're no longer human beings, but you've become swine. So the talent of human beings is degenerated into feeding swine. So my gift that God gave me, now I use it to tell filthy jokes, to make you laugh at filth, keeping your mind in the gutter while somebody else is taking America away from the people. Look at yourself. You've been used. They send you to war, so they say, in the name of democracy, and you die on foreign battlefields to come back home.
Right.
Filled with disease, and the government don't care no more about the veterans of foreign wars and the veterans who have given their life for this country. It's all about money. It ain't about democracy. Lyndon Johnson was a deceiver who lied about the Tonkin Gulf incident, and 500,000 American soldiers went to war in Vietnam. Government full of liars. A government full of deceivers that use the poor to fight, bleed, and die for a democracy that the poor don't have.
That's right.
The education has gone to hell. 19% of white people graduating from high school and are proficient in mathematics, while 81% of whites that graduate from high school are not proficient in mathematics. Amen. 6% of Hispanic students who graduate from high school are proficient in mathematics, while 94% of Hispanic students graduate not proficient in mathematics. 2% of black students graduate from high school proficient in mathematics, while 98% of black students graduate from high school not proficient in mathematics. Mathematics is the key science. It is the mother of all science. And he who doesn't have proficiency in mathematics cannot build civilization. Those who are most proficient in mathematics in America today are the Asian students. 39% of them graduate with mathematical proficiency, while 61% graduate not proficient. So who is the future coming to? You white supremacists who think because you're white, you the goose that laid the golden egg. But now the Asians are running your butt off the planet with your racist self. Fastest growing economy in the world are the Asians. You're crying today, sending your representative to China to beg the Chinese.
Go ahead.
Come on.
Clean up your human rights. Or we'll deny you favored trading status. And the Chinese smile.
Yes, sir.
Say, you better get yourself back to Washington. You left China and you went to Japan.
Yes.
You said to the Japanese, the trade difference between us.
Yes.
We gotta cut it back. You got $1 billion, billions of dollars, in a trade imbalance.
Yes, sir.
Ours is imbalanced. We're losing $100 billion a year in our trading.
Yes, sir. All right.
Come on. Can't we get along? The Japanese look at you and smile and say, oh, yes, we will try harder to fix you. We will try to do better. The Chinese and Japanese musicians, the Chinese and Japanese and Koreans buying up all the most expensive instruments and paintings, taking them back to China and Japan and Korea. Look at you. You're buying more drugs than any nation on earth. What's the matter with you, America? There's more drugs being sold in America than any country on the earth.
That's right.
You are now the greatest drug center in the world.
That's right.
The greatest crime center in the world. The number one murder and crime rate in the world. More people incarcerated in America than anywhere else in the world. More insane people in America than anywhere else in the world. More people on pills in America than anywhere else in the world. When you want to go to sleep, take a pill. When you want to wake up, take a pill. When you want to stop from eating, take a pill. When you want to eat more, take a pill. When you get a headache, take a pill. When you get acid indigestion, take a pill. When you want to get high, take another pill. When you want to slow down, take another pill. When you want to do this, take a drink. You're the biggest drug-consuming nation in the world, legal and illegal. Can't you see, America, what's happening to you? Look at you! You long haired lice fill! Guitar plucking, funk driven people! Look at you.
Somebody has to stand up for you. Somebody has to wake the masses up. Somebody has to help you get control of your life and your destiny again. Somebody has to perform a duty by you. It may cost that somebody their life. But what is life for? See, life is to be lived and life is to die for precious principles that are eternal. Life is to be lived for the sake of truth. And we die for the sake of truth. All right. Life is to be lived for the principle of freedom, justice, and equality. And we should die for freedom, justice, and equality. Life is should be lived for the principle of brotherhood. And life should be given for that principle.
All right. Yes. Amen.
So, my teacher, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, a man that most of you know very little about, a man whom we believe God raised up to champion the cause of freedom, justice, and equality, first for the black masses of the people, because we black people are the most deprived when it comes to knowledge of self and knowledge of others. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad worked for 44 years, the most self-sacrificing man I have ever met in my life. And like Jesus, who met Peter fishing, he met him working, but he said, Peter, I got another job for you. He said, if you would come and follow me, I will make you a fisher of men.
Amen.
Because people are drowning in the sea of sin and iniquity.
Right. Yes, sir.
But Peter, if you follow me, your name will live in history.
Yes.
If you would separate yourself from your personal desire and follow me, Peter, you'll be a fisher of men. When I met Elijah Muhammad, my desire was to be a great singer of songs, a master of the violin, and a great entertainer, because I felt that God had brought me here to make people happy with my music. But when I met Elijah Muhammad and Malcolm X, they called me out of my music to become a fisher of men. I gave it all up for the word of God.
All right.
I never knew that I could speak. I never knew that I had the gift, because I used to stammer and stutter as a young boy.
Oh, Lord.
But Elijah Muhammad knew me before I knew myself.
All right.
And he said to me one day, you think music is your great gift, but your great gift is your spiritual gifts. I want you to put your music down. He said, music is a god. And if you don't watch it, that god will make you bow down to it before you bow down to the true God. And so I gave up my music. I didn't know where the future would carry me. I only knew that I loved you, and I've been loving you since I was a little boy. I used to cry myself to sleep at night.
All right.
over the suffering of black people.
Yes, sir.
I never experienced what my people experience. But because God made me of such a sensitive nature, I don't need to experience it. I just need to identify with you who have experienced it, and I feel what you feel. That's why I don't speak with notes, because the notes are written already in my being. I'm not just a great orator. There have been many orators, skilled orators. This is not oratorical skill. This is a man who's made by God to vibrate to the pain and the suffering of his people and all human beings. Even those of you who would like to hate me, once you get in my presence and you feel me, not what the press said about me, but you feel me, then you know there's something more to this man than what the media has said or what the media has seen or what the Jews have said or what the Jews have seen or what the government has said and what the government has seen. I love you too. When I play the violin, there's a difference between a violin that's worth $500, a violin that's worth $5,000, and a violin that's worth $500,000, and a violin that's worth $2 million. They all look the same, but they're not the same. Something about the craftsmanship.
Yeah.
Something about the wood that was chosen. Something about the varnish on the wood. Something about the tonal quality of the instrument that makes it vibrate sound with overtones and undertones that make one violin of magnificent richness and another one of tinny quality. And so it is with the hearts of human beings. When God makes a man for you, God crafts his heart so that when the word comes through him, it vibrates in such a way that no man who speaks the word can speak it with the same results, because the heart isn't made like that man. They can sound like him. They can imitate him. But the imitation is not the real. There never was a man like Farrakhan. And there never will be a man like Farrakhan again. I, like you, am unique, but I am born and made for this hour. There is no power that can stop Farrakhan from doing what God has laid on my heart to do. You can forget it. You can't weaken me down with your scoundrelizing and demonizing of me. Because the moment I present myself, I am the truth of what I am. And the truth of what I am destroys in a moment the lies that you have told about me. This is why they don't want you to hear what I have to say. They hate me.
All right.
What do you hate me for?
Yes, Lord.
Because I'm exposing the crooked, the deceitful, the treacherous way
of those who have smiled in your face and played like they were your friends and your benefactors while they were seeking and carrying out your destruction at the same time. To my Muslim brothers and sisters, I may be unorthodox to you.
All right.
And I understand your concerns. Yes, sir. As Muslims. I understand your feelings.
Yeah, yeah.
I understand the way you think.
Yes, sir.
And I'm not condemning. But if I am in error, and you are right, then why is God blessing me? God would not bless me if I am in error. He would not make me to overcome the power of my enemies if I were in error. I have to be the moral superior of those who are my enemies in order for God to give me victory over them.
That's right. That's right. All right.
I'm not saying I'm a holy man. I didn't come down from heaven.
That's right.
I rose up from hell. I'm not without sin.
All right.
I need God's mercy.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
But I'm striving every day of my life to be a better human being.
Yeah.
I want the Jews in this audience to know
that
I don't hate you because of your faith. What kind of man would I be? To hate you because
Amen.
You are a Jew, when we all claim Abraham
Amen.
As our father.
Right.
I want you to listen to me.
Oh, yeah.
I'm not afraid of you, so I have no reason to lie.
All right.
I never called Judaism a gutter religion.
All right.
Listen.
Listen.
Amen.
That's what Amen. The papers said.
Yes,
and they continue to repeat it.
All right.
When I have clarified for 10 years,
that's right.
But it's because you feel, well, niggas lie.
Listen. All right.
You give your own people the benefit of the doubt. Any racist cracker can say any foul thing about black people. And all he has to do is give you one little apology and it's all over with. Reverend Jackson used the term Hymetown. And he's been apologizing ever since. But nothing that he does, nothing that he says, it's always too little, too late. Farrakhan is not an apologist. If whatever I say, I believe it to be the truth, then I'm willing to die on that truth. But if you show me where I am in error, I will apologize before the entire world because I want to be right. I don't want to injure you or any other human being. And if the truth that I speak hurts you, then you are the guilty party. Listen. You're looking for Elijah.
Go ahead.
At your Seder,
right.
You leave room at your table
right.
For Elijah.
Go ahead.
You open the door for Elijah.
Yes. Go ahead.
Right.
You leave a glass of wine
right.
For Elijah.
Yes. Right.
But you don't
open the door fully, you just leave it ajar.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Why Elijah?
Come on, right?
Because Elijah must first come and restore all things, because Elijah is the trumpet that lets you know the Messiah is on his way.
That's right.
The Jews have never believed that Jesus of 2,000 years ago was in fact the Messiah. If they believed 2,000 years ago that Jesus was in fact the Messiah, they would all follow him. They don't even believe that he's a prophet of God. Therefore, the New Testament is not the book that they read.
That's right.
That's right.
They are still looking for the Messiah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. When I lie, you stop me.
In a sense, the Jews are not wrong.
All right.
Jesus of 2,000 years ago was the last great sign and said as much if you read John 14, 15, 16.
All right.
Jesus is talking about one coming after him.
That's right.
Clear.
Yes.
All right.
Jesus didn't say, I will do this. He said, when he is come. The Spirit of truth. He will guide you into all truth. He said, I go to my Father, and you see me no more, but I'm going to send you one in my name, and he's going to testify of me. This is your Bible. I'm not misquoting you. Jesus never told you to worship him. In the gospel, he said, God is a spirit. And you must worship him, not worship me. Worship him in spirit and in truth, for such the Father seeketh. Jesus never told you to bow down to him. He said, come, follow me. And that's your fault, Christian. You ain't following Jesus. You're following Satan in the name of Jesus. Satan has come down unto you having great wrath, showing himself to be an angel of light, and he's taken over the church. You talk about on this rock, I build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Where is there more hell than in the so-called house of God? Your house has been taken over. Satan is in the pulpit. Satan is guiding the house. Preachers are afraid to preach the gospel. Cowardly preachers, bought and paid for preachers. This is why Jesus called you hirelings. Afraid of the wolf, you allow the sheep to be eaten up. This is a people eaten up by Satan. Where's the good shepherd? Where's the good shepherd? Where's the shepherd that will give his life for the sheep, and you're scared as hell to stand up and fight for your people? But you would fight me before I even get to the city. He is a rabbi, and the preachers all arm in arm.
All right.
Fighting a man of God. Well, this is exactly what you've been doing in history.
Amen. Hypocritical rabbis. Hypocritical priests. That's why Jesus called you whited sepulchres. And in you is the bones of dead men. You look pure on the outside, but rotten as hell on the inside. And you got all my people on the inside of your churches. These are dead men and women. They don't have no power. They got eyes, but they can't see. They got ears, but they can't hear. They got tongues, but they can't speak. They're on a dead level, but who's going to raise them to a living perpendicular? Not no mealy-mouthed, cowardly preacher. It's going to take a man of God. Men and women of God. Men who fear God and not fear the consequences of telling truth. I'm ashamed that there still are such men around who claim God as their father, but weak to stand up for the people. So I'm happy to be in Fresno. I thank God for for Brother Nellums and the NAACP that invited me to Fresno. I thank God for my young brother Larry and the Muslim community that sold tickets to fill this auditorium even though they boycotted this event. If I've hurt any of your feelings, I didn't mean to. I only mean to tell the truth. I am no Hitler.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
And I never desire to see any Jewish man, woman, or child in any oven like Hitler did. It's an evil thing of you to paint me as a Hitler simply because God is allowing me to reach my people.
That's right.
And you don't control me. I want you to know you will never control me. You don't have enough money to buy me. There's nothing that you have that I want bad enough that will make me bow down to you when God and God alone is he who is worthy to be bowed to. You want to make me the murderer of Malcolm X. After 30 long years, you have tried men and convicted them of the murder. Now, 30 years later, you want to say Farrakhan had something to do with it. I want to talk to you tonight about the evil machinations of Satan. Well, he's being sued. $4.4 billion. You say, well, Farrakhan, that's a lot of money. You're not going to get it. Maybe not. But the reason they're saying this
is to first discredit the man because he's getting more popular. Second, to set him up for trial and false imprisonment.
All right.
And third, to incite his murder. You're so afraid, you know you can't deal with me on the basis of truth.
Yes, sir. That's right.
So you want me dead.
Amen.
They have already determined that I must die. Oh, they ain't gonna kill me or you. You have determined now that somebody got to shut my mouth. That decision has already been made.
All right.
Now let's see who God is. You do everything in your power to take my life. And I'll be here to watch you die. I represent the God that you talk about. And I'm in his bosom. Couldn't be a safer place to be than in the bosom of him who has power over all things. So you do what you gotta do. And I'm gonna do what I gotta do.
Yes,
Satan, you're not gonna win this round or no more rounds from this time on. Your day is over, baby. Let me tell you why they charged me with Malcolm's murder. Did you know 30 years ago when Malcolm was assassinated, if you were to go to the microfilm or microfiche and look at the New York daily newspapers, not one of them had anything kind to say about Malcolm. Not one of the 11 daily newspapers. Many of those newspapers were owned by Jews. Now I want you to listen. Any Jewish person in here, I want you to hear me. Now this part of it is directed to you, as well as to my people. You're just gonna deal with facts. The New York Times, that prints all the news that's fit to print, had on its front page, and I quote, "The day after Malcolm died, he died or was killed on February the 21st in the Audubon Ballroom, 1 week after his house was firebombed."
Yes, sir.
And he went to the police to ask for protection. But in the Audubon Ballroom, there were no uniformed policemen, nowhere in sight.
Come on.
Why? Why was it on that particular day nobody that entered the ballroom was searched? The men who perpetrated Malcolm's assassination said they went to the door, and when they found nobody was searching, they went back to their car and brought their weapons in and assassinated Malcolm X. Two men were caught on the scene. Two men, the first newspaper said, two men. But by the next editions, it was only one man. Who was the other man?
Come on.
Where did he go?
Yes, sir.
Let's talk about it.
Come on.
A few days later, two members of the Harlem Mosque were arrested for the murder of Malcolm X.
Right.
Both of them had alibis. They were not on the scene. And the strange thing, in the courtroom, Talmadge Hayer, the one that was caught at the scene, who was one of the perpetrators, said, and I quote, "These two were no part of it." And they were asked, "Name the others who were." And he wouldn't give up his co-conspirators. And so those two men were sent to prison for 26 years of their life,
yes,
for a crime that they did not commit.
That's right.
They lost their families.
Yes, sir.
But thanks be to Almighty God, they didn't lose their minds.
Yes, sir.
They were Muslims,
yes,
and they went through their imprisonment.
Yes, sir.
And today, those two are out, but still suffering from the stigma of being an assassin. But sometime during the 26 years, the one who was one of the perpetrators named all five,
yes, sir,
who were a party to the murder.
Yeah.
William Kunstler took over the case and tried to get the government to reopen the case so that the two innocent men could go free, that justice may be served. But the government refused to open the case.
Right.
Why?
Right. Come on. Right. Come on.
White people didn't like Malcolm X.
Right.
You hypocrites today.
Right.
They didn't like Malcolm. And they certainly didn't like the Nation of Islam that gave birth to Malcolm.
No, sir.
So let's use one stone or bird against another and cancel them out. So to say that the Nation killed Malcolm,
yes, sir,
why in the hell did the Nation kill him? Why didn't you arrest everybody in the Nation and try the whole Nation for the murder? How can the Nation be responsible for the murder of an individual? You fair-minded Negroes. Who don't see why all white people should be blamed for what some white people have done. You fair-minded Negroes. You can find an excuse for all the white people that you sleep with, who are the children of your fathers and slavers.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
You can justify that.
Yes, sir.
But then I can hear you say the Nation killed Malcolm.
That's what they say.
All right.
That's what they say.
Now, in the meantime, oh, by the way,
come on,
the New York Times said,
come on,
the apostle of hate,
that's what they call him,
is dead. Let me say it again.
That's what they said.
Who was Malcolm 30 years ago? Malcolm was what Louis Farrakhan is today.
That's right. That's right.
Come on, let's reason together. All you writers, all you teachers, all you Jews and Gentiles, let's reason.
Come on.
The apostle of hate,
come on,
is dead.
That's what they said.
Now, any of you who want to do some research, I wish you would.
All right.
Go back and get the files of the Anti-Defamation League.
Come on. Come on.
And see what their dossier was on Malcolm X 30 years ago.
Yes,
they love to give you when they know I'm coming.
Right.
They pass out literature on Farrakhan's words.
Yes, sir.
I would be glad to sit down in a synagogue with the board of rabbis and the Jewish people.
Yes, sir.
And you can question me on any word that I said.
Yes, sir.
And if I can't defend any word that I said with truth, then I'll go before the world and apologize. That's my offer to you.
Yes, sir.
But to come and ask me to apologize before dialogue is an arrogant, racist, bigoted, hateful position. You want me to bow down because you're used to crushing all that come into opposition from your vantage point. You crush them out. You made Ford bow down. But I ain't Ford. I'm talking about Ford. Henry Ford. You made him bow down and recant everything that he said and everything that he wrote. You made all your enemies bow down. Well, here's one. Only way you can make me bow is present me with truth.
Yes, sir.
And if you tell the truth and your truth exposes what I believe to be truth as falsehood, you ain't got to ask me to bow. I'm a man.
Come on, brother.
I love truth.
Yes, sir.
I'll bow and I'll go before the world and say, I was wrong. That's my pledge in the public to you. But, you can't show me I'm wrong if there's no dialogue. Why don't you want a dialogue with me? What is this stupid no-talk policy? Look how silly you are. Russia and America sitting down talking. Yasser Arafat and Rabin and everybody sitting down trying to talk. Intelligent people encourage dialogue. You want a dialogue in the black community. We want a better black Jewish relations. Well, who are you talking to? The people are with me, buddy. You don't want a real dialogue. You want a dialogue with the people you're already in control of. That ain't no dialogue. What the hell are you afraid of? Let's sit down and talk. I've been trying to get a dialogue with you for 10 years. Isn't that something? It ain't because I'm afraid. Somebody said Farrakhan played his violin. He offering an olive branch with a violin.
That's what they said.
He must need some money.
That's what they said.
If I do, I ain't coming to you. Not for any personal money. I will be seeing you soon. Excuse me while I walk and talk. I haven't forgotten my subject. I know it's time to go. But this is my closing subject. Because Malcolm is very important in the black community. And to try to label me as his murderer is a very malicious and wicked thing for Satan to do. But Satan is nothing too low down for Satan to do. Now, if you open up the ADL files and go back and look 30 years ago at Malcolm, according to the ADL's view of Malcolm, Malcolm was the leading black anti-Semite 30 years ago. Did you know that?
Come on.
You didn't know? But let me tell you. You know why they said Malcolm was the leading black anti-Semite? Because Malcolm and the Nation of Islam were separatists. And the NAACP and the Big Six were integrationists.
Yes, sir.
Brother Nellums, Malcolm discovered that Mr. Spingarn, who was the father, one of the founding fathers of the NAACP, was Jewish. He was always hidden, while you always had a black man out front. But he and Kivi Kaplan and others were calling the shots. And then we learned that Spingarn was an operative of the CIA.
Yeah.
Wait now, wait.
Yeah.
Oh, we're on a truth mission. We gotta tell it. We learned from the Memphis appeal.
Yes, sir.
1993. Spingarn was a member of the CIA and used the NAACP as a spy thing to spy on black leaders.
Yes, sir.
Come on, they didn't hear you, brother.
Come on. Yes, sir.
So I couldn't accept the Spingarn medal.
Yes, sir.
As tainted.
Yeah.
Come on.
Malcolm pointed out that not only was the NAACP founded by members of the Jewish community, but the Urban League, course, Nick, all of them.
Yes.
And in the NAACP founding papers,
they
were not to deal with economics. They were to deal with civil rights issues. Well, hell, your people are poor, ragged, hungry, naked, and out of doors. What do you mean we shouldn't deal with economics? Go check it out.
That's right.
You ain't never dealt with economics. The NAACP never dealt with the real needs of a people.
That's right. That's right.
This is why. No, I gotta tell it.
Got it.
I'm a life member, y'all.
Yes, sir. Got it.
That's right.
I think I should have a right to speak.
Yes, sir.
And I wouldn't listen. I wouldn't be the man that I am if it were not for the Crisis magazine.
Come on.
And W.E.B. Du Bois, who my mother would give me the Crisis when I was a little boy to read W.E.B. Du Bois.
Okay, sir.
So I owe a lot to the NAACP. Now, Malcolm exposed the hypocrisy in the civil rights movement.
Yes.
Listen to what I'm saying.
Come on.
See, many of you in Fresno look like Mississippi.
Yes.
Y'all all right? Let me talk to you. This is a little old country town in the middle of fast-moving California, and California moving over you, under you, and around you, and leave you standing still. Fresno. Must be like they're frozen you. Fresno. But you remind me of the beauty of Southern folk. I listen to your church, and it sound like rural Alabama and Mississippi. You got a good feel here, a down home feel. Oh yeah, there's a beauty in Fresno. It's true. But when we were in the South under segregation, we had bus company, gas station, motel, hotel, insurance company, black doctors, black lawyers, black accountants. Black people kept their money revolving in their own community, building up where black people live all throughout the South. Is that right? Jews couldn't get in here, Jews couldn't get in there, didn't want Jews here, didn't want Jews there. So blacks and Jews united to do what? to break down the legal barriers that kept Jews and blacks out where Jews and blacks belong. Fine. Beautiful. So we worked together. You know, anybody that is in the backfield always has to give credit to the lineman that opened the hole. You see, black folks were used to open the hole for Jews and gays and women to go through, leaving black folk behind. Talk back to me. Yes, Goodman and Schwerner, Cheney, they died. You say that like, you know, that's so great. Yeah, they died. But for every progressive step, people die. But when you focus on two Jews, when hundreds of blacks die, then what are you telling me? That your life is more valuable than the black people who died to open a way for you? Yeah, that's exactly what they're saying. That black life don't have no value. But when a Jew will die for you, that's like 1,000 or 10,000 or 100,000 or 1,000,000 blacks dying. And that's why when those Palestinians were shot to death in Hebron, while they were in an act of worship, I didn't hear no rabbis talking about how terrible it was. I didn't hear Jesse Jackson come out and say, you rabbis ought to speak up, like he said we ought to speak up against Brother Khaled. I didn't hear you Negro leaders. And the rabbi said, when they buried Baruch Goldstein, that his fingernail was worth the life of 1,000,000 Palestinians. That's how much value they put on their lives. And that's how much they devalue the lives of those who are non-Jewish. And that's bigotry. That's wrong. He didn't say 100 black eyes for one Jewish eye. He said an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, and a life for a life. But if you think, because I said that the black Holocaust was 100 times worse than the Holocaust of Jews. I'm not minimizing Jewish suffering. I'm not saying you didn't suffer and that should have been. But I'm comparing the loss of lives of black people. And then Jews took me to task saying, he had a nerve to say. Why would you say that? Because you feel that you're alive. Are more valuable than the life of a goyim, an unbeliever, or the life of a Gentile. Yes, sir. That leads to racist and religious supremacy. Yes, when you say you're the people of God and the chosen of God, you're the chosen of God to do some service. Not to wear that on your shoulder as a badge of supremacy. Lest God take it from you and give it to somebody else, which he has done. I want you to listen, NAACP. I want you to listen. Malcolm pointed this out. So the ADL felt Malcolm was an anti-Semite.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Do you know the first time I ever read the protocols of the learned elders of Zion? I never knew anything about that thing. You know who gave it to me? Malcolm X. I read it, but I never heard the Honorable Elijah Muhammad comment on it. So I never, never used what I read in that as anything for me to say, but he gave it to me to read. The same Malcolm that died or was killed in 1965, next year will be 30 years. When he died, he was the leading black anti-Semite. Who am I? Who am I? In their eyes, who am I? I'm the leading black anti-Semite. Who am I in the eyes of white America? Who am I? The apostle of hate. When have you seen a black man on the cover of Time magazine? Other than Idi Amin.
Come on, brother, let me talk.
That was as vilified, a ministry of rage, spewer of venom against whites and all Jews. Why do so many black people say he speaks for them? Well, if in their eyes I'm an apostle of hate and an anti-Semite, but you don't see me that way. When you accept me, you become anti-Semitic and a hater. Arsenio Hall had good relationships with whites, good relationships with Jews. Arsenio asked me to come on his show for Black History Month. I said, sure. What did he do that for? They threatened to take his show from him. They called him all kinds of vicious names. Now, according to what he said on television the other night, Jews have said they'll never come on his show again. What is that? Is that love or is that hate? Here's a man that had a good relationship with Jews, but because he invited me on the show, now he's an anti-Semite.
Yes, sir.
Mayor Tom Bradley, Bradley. Mayor Bradley. He had a beautiful relationship with the Jewish community for over 20 years. And because he didn't condemn me as fast as members of the Jewish community thought he should have, they called him what? Anti-Semite. Nelson Mandela. Because he received money from Arafat and went to Libya to thank Gaddafi and Arafat and Fidel Castro.
Yes, sir.
They called Nelson Mandela what?
Anti-Semite.
Yes,
sir.
Poor Jesse.
Yes,
sir. He frees Jews from Russia. He does everything he knows to show them, look, I'm not that. What do they call Jesse?
Anti-Semite.
What the hell does anti-Semite mean? Poor Andrew, our first ambassador to the United Nations. Andrew Young. Check this out. He meets with Tertsy of the PLO. Now they got a no-talk policy. Nobody's supposed to talk to the PLO. He goes, you know Sam don't go talk to nobody unless white folks say Sam go there. ends up talking to Tertzi. When he tries to duck and dodge and get out of it, guess what? The ADL had bugged his room. Not the FBI, not the CIA, the ADL, the spy organization, bugged him and told him exactly what he said, exactly what Tercy said, and forced Jimmy Carter to let him go. And black-Jewish relationships begin to split real wide then. Well, I'm saying all of that to say, if Malcolm 30 years ago was the leading black anti-Semite and the apostle of hate, and he died, he didn't even have a chance to clean up his image. How did his image get cleaned up? Who cleaned it up? And for what purpose? Now Malcolm is no longer who Malcolm was. Malcolm's a civil rights leader. When was Malcolm a civil rights leader? Talk back to me. I know Malcolm. Malcolm never was a civil rights leader. Malcolm always talked about human rights and not civil rights, because human rights have to come first, then civil rights. Talk to me. Oh. Now Malcolm's image is sanitized. Who wiped it up? Who cleaned it? And for what purpose? You know what? To the members of the Jewish community in the audience, I met with some Jewish rabbis about maybe 7 months ago. They had had dinner at my house a few years ago, and they invited me to come to their home and have dinner with them, and I went. I took my son and chief of staff, my wife, and a few others. We had a lovely dinner. And at the end of the dinner, the rabbi reached in his pocket and pulled out a list. He said, I don't want you to think that this is a love feast. If anything, it's tough love. He said, Farrakhan, he said, I'm going to just cut it real short. He said, look, you've said a lot of things that have offended the Jewish community. And so if there's going to be good relationships between you and the Jewish community, we need a long history of you, of saying good words and doing good deeds. Secondly, we want you to disavow that book, Secret Relationship Between Blacks and Jews, because that is a great calumny against the Jewish people. Third, we want you to go down in history as a friend of the Jewish people, for no one who is anti-Semitic has ever been written of well in history. And if you will do this, listen to the words now, if you will do this, we will clean up your image. Is that what they said, son?
They said it. They said it.
Well, y'all gonna clean up my image. You know why you gonna clean it up? Because you dirtied it up. And it's your mess, you should clean it up. But look at the conditions. We're gonna clean up your image if you do this. He said, you don't have to respond now. Wait till we go upstairs and have coffee, then you can respond. I went upstairs and I drank the coffee. But I was a little nervous now, because I knew how I was going to respond.
Yes, sir.
And I'll give you my response. And I knew from the day that I gave this response that it would be all out war. I said to them, sir, Isaiah the prophet says, justice stands afar off, and equity cannot enter because truth has fallen in the streets. I said, you talk about your truth and my truth. I said, until we recognize truth, then there's no justice then between us. It can't be your truth and my truth. It can be your perception of truth and my perception of truth, but we've got to agree on what the truth is. I said, now, there's more history of your people doing evil to mine than mine doing evil to yours. So maybe if there's going to be a relationship, we need a long history on you. I'm telling you what I said. I said, now this book, Secret Relationship, I'll disavow it tomorrow morning, because if it's a lie, I don't want a lie attached to my name. I said, however, we didn't write the book. I said, we only researched what Jewish scholars, rabbis, and historians said about your role in the slave trade. So I'll tell you what, if you stand up tomorrow and condemn all the Jews that we have quoted as liars and perpetrating a calumny against the Jewish people, if you do that, I'll throw the book away. I ain't heard from that. Third, I said, I want to be your friend. That's why I'm at your table for dinner. I said, but if being your friend means I got to compromise the principle of truth, then yours is a friendship I don't need, and yours is a friendship I don't want. I said, I would much rather go down in history as a friend of God. That ended the night. And I knew from that moment on, it was going to escalate. Now let's get clothes on Malcolm and then we can go home. 30 years later, Malcolm's image is clean. Because the same people who dirtied Malcolm's are the same people that dirtied mine. Same people that own Newsweek and Time. Same people that run and write the editorials in these papers across America. Same radio news commentators who call Malcolm an apostle of hate. How in the hell can a white man fix your mouth?
Think about that. Teach on the fire.
To call us apostles of hate with 430 years of your people's hatred and evil against black people. How can you do that? How can you do it? You want to leave that man alone. Leave that man alone. He can't jump over there. Now, I don't think he wants to do that. Leave that man alone. He's gathering the news. And I really don't care how you write. It's all right with me. Anything you write is going to help me. So if you don't want to help me, don't write nothing at all. Because if you call me a hater, an anti-Semite, it's going to help me. Because all these people in here heard me tonight. They heard what I had to say. Now, let me tell you what the real motive is. Here's the real deal. They have always used one black man against another.
Always.
Whenever one black man is bold and speaks out, they get another black man to attack him.
Yes, sir.
Isn't that the history?
Yes, sir.
But look at this. Farrakhan has risen so in America that they don't know who to use. They want to use Jesse against me, but that won't work. They don't have a so-called Negro leader that they can use effectively against Farrakhan. Farrakhan is the first leader in the history of our sojourn in America that has a root now down in the youth. Check it out. Malcolm never had the youth while he was alive. Neither did Martin Luther King. The masses of black people didn't follow Dr. King because the masses of black people didn't turn the other cheek. The masses of black people loved Dr. King for his stand for us, but we didn't agree that if somebody smacked us, that That's we right. should be nonviolent. We believe that if they smack us, we should break their damn neck. That's what we believe. Isn't that right? Don't you agree with that? We shouldn't be aggressive, but if anybody aggresses on us, don't you think we ought to fight with those who fight with us? Well, now we're at the end. So you know what they felt? They said, Farrakhan is getting strong. If we don't have anybody alive to fight him, let's raise one from the dead. Now, all of you who love Malcolm X, that got pictures of Malcolm on your wall, you don't have the power to raise Malcolm and make Malcolm an icon.
Go ahead.
All you can say is, I read his autobiography, I really dig the man, and that's all. But if you notice, in the last 7 years, articles have been showing up on Malcolm in the various publications, newspapers, magazines across the country. You don't see this as orchestrated, but I do. See, you're a sheep, remember? And they're going to herd you into a particular mode. They work like this because they got control. At least they thought so. God is in control today. Your stuff ain't working no more. Ain't that something? Oh, boy, they're all messed up. They can't believe it. They've cussed me out. They've said all kind of evil. And here you come out. Pay $25. And I'm not singing. I'm not dancing. They can't believe this. In Fresno. In Fresno. Something going on in Fresno. Brothers and sisters, they raised Malcolm up. They made him an icon. They did this purposely. They cleaned up Malcolm's image in the eyes of the public, in whose mind they besmirched him. They really did a job on Malcolm. And you know it, and I know it. Check this out now. They raised Malcolm, and then Warner Brothers, after 25 years, nobody could make the movie. Warner Brothers decides we're going to make a movie. Now, I'm going to ask you a question. When has a Jew made a movie on an anti-Semite that made the anti-Semite an idol? Come on. Jews make more movies on Hitler than anybody else. Nobody writes on Hitler more than Jews. But you don't make Hitler no icon for people to admire. You paint Hitler with the brush that history, the history that you write, wants the world to see Hitler in. Now, what was your purpose for cleaning up Malcolm's image, since he was the leading black anti-Semite and the apostle of hate? You don't mention that now. Why? Because your desire was to raise him and then put $30 million in the hands of Spike Lee to make a movie glorifying the value of Malcolm and diminishing the value of Elijah Muhammad. For history's sake, no, because you knew that the Nation of Islam and Elijah Muhammad and Louis Farrakhan were coming to popularity in the black community, and you wanted to blunt and stunt that growth and turn the guns in the black community against the unarmed men of the Nation of Islam. That was what they had in their mind. But the Holy Quran says they plan and God plans. Now look at how their plan worked. Warner Brothers, Jewish people, said, we ran out of money. They ran out of money.
First time in history.
They ran out of money to make the movie. So Spike had to go get $5 million. Who did Spike go to? Bill Cosby? Oprah Winfrey? Magic Johnson? Went to black people with money. Why? They wanted to hook them into the film so that they would have a monetary as well as a spiritual reason for the success of the film. And so if we attack the film, which they expected us to do, we would alienate ourselves from this high profile black folk. Oh, they had it all worked out. They had it all worked out, brother. Now everybody got on the X cap to get away from the excuse of not becoming ex-addicts, ex-pimps, and ex-convicts. Everybody was roped in. Denzel did a beautiful job. He was magnificent. The whole cast was great. The movie was really a great movie. I don't like the way they depicted my leader.
That's right.
But if you look at the big picture, it was a good movie.
Yeah.
I'll tell you why at another time. From my vantage point, it was great. But if you notice, they expected the Muslims to picket, followers of Elijah Muhammad, to picket the theaters and hype it. And I told all my ministers, be quiet. Don't say nothing. At the same time that the movie came out, books came out, The Judas Factor. Betty and all of the old followers of Malcolm went on the speaking circuit.
Right.
And who were they condemning? Who were they condemning? Elijah Muhammad. Well, if Elijah Muhammad is a no good man and I'm representing him, then I can't be too good myself. So we just kept quiet. We didn't say nothing. And the movie went up and it went right on down. They played it over and again and over again for youth. They would run youth into the theater. Why you young people? They ain't never made Du Bois, no movie on Du Bois, no movie on Marcus Garvey, no movie on Toussaint Louverture, no movie on great black people. They made a movie on Malcolm, but the purpose was to use a dead man against the only living voice that black people in America has that has not been bought, not been paid for, can't be bought. Now, 1 year later, Farrakhan and his minister Khalid makes a statement, several of them, and everybody in the world is upset. Khalid's statements. They're not upset over deeds. They're upset over black man's words. After this, Farrakhan is the real object of attack. They just used Khalid to get to me.
That's right. Came right out.
So when I had my press conference and literally wiped away their stuff, they went crazy for a minute, got their bearings, and ever since they've been attacking me daily. Daily. They brought Sister Shabazz on a television show and they showed her a clip of me.
Go ahead.
Now, I knew Sister Betty before she and Malcolm got married. Malcolm took my oldest daughter, put my oldest daughter on his knee, and taught my oldest daughter what is called our student enrollment. And I was that close to Attila, his first daughter. We were like a family. But it's true, when Malcolm deviated from Elijah Muhammad, I had a choice to make. I would either follow Malcolm or follow Elijah Muhammad. And I made the decision not to follow the student, but to follow the teacher. I know that I'm not wrong in following the teacher. And if I had to do it all over again, I would follow the teacher. Malcolm incited the nation by the words that he spoke against his teacher. I know that Malcolm knew better. When Malcolm learned that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad had wives, not consorts, not concubines, but wives. When he mentioned it to me, he blew my mind. But I went home, couldn't sleep, and opened this book, Quran, early in the morning to the 33rd surah, which talks about the wives of Prophet Muhammad. And any Muslim in here who is a student of the Quran and a follower of Prophet Muhammad knows that God gave the Prophet the authority and the right,
that's right,
to take wives.
Yes, sir.
Listen now. And Muhammad didn't want to do it. And Allah said to Muhammad in this book, why do you forbid yourself that which I have made lawful to you? There are some men who fear men as they ought to fear Allah. When I saw this, I called Malcolm. I said, Malcolm, I found something in the Quran that I'd like to discuss with you. And I flew from Boston to New York, and I talked to him about what I found in the Quran. And as Allah is my witness, Malcolm said to me, I already know that. But you can't handle this, Louis. Let me handle it. When he said to me, I already know that, Louis, that meant to me that he knew how to defend his teacher's actions.
Yes, sir.
But because he was angry with his teacher for sitting him down for the remark that he made about Kennedy, which endangered the Muslims, he began to say that Elijah Muhammad had sex with his teenaged secretaries and made them pregnant. I even hate to repeat the slander.
Yes, sir.
Because when you know better and say that about the man that took you from a prison cell,
yes, sir,
and cleaned you up and never asked you what you did when you were a pimp, when you were a drug user, when you were a robber, a bank robber, and a hustler, Elijah Muhammad never asked him what was. He cleaned him up and put him before the world like he did me and countless thousands of others. And for the student to say that of his teacher, he incited in us an anger and a hatred that did go to murder.
Yes, sir.
I have to tell the truth.
Yes, sir.
It's like somebody talking to you about your mother.
Yes,
If you wouldn't fight them for nothing else, when they start talking about your mother, that's time to fight.
That's right.
Well, that's the way we were incited.
Yes.
But Elijah Muhammad said to us, leave Malcolm alone. Leave him to Allah. And every one of us who loved Elijah Muhammad and were obedient to him never would harm a hair on Malcolm's head. But just like it is in every prophetic community, there are zealots. When David's son Absalom rose up against David, David told Joab when they went out to fight David's son, said, if you catch my son, don't kill him. Bring him to me. When Absalom's hair got caught up in a tree and Absalom couldn't help himself, Joab forgot the instructions of his king. So incensed was he over what Absalom had done, he spared Absalom through. And when they brought Absalom back to his father David dead, all Israel was rejoicing. But they could hear David in his tent crying, saying over and over again, my son, my son. My son.
Yes, sir.
When Malcolm was assassinated, Elijah Muhammad's grandson was in the room when the news came over the radio. And Elijah Muhammad said, oh my God, according to the grandson, oh my God. Malcolm was like his son.
Yes, sir.
He was angry with Malcolm. But he left Malcolm to Allah.
That's right.
Go ahead.
And now the writers, when Elijah Muhammad was among us, they said Elijah ordered it. Now Elijah's gone. There's no more Elijah. But Farrakhan is left. He's alive.
Yes.
And the whole world is turning toward Farrakhan now. And Satan can't stand it, so he wants you to believe that I murdered Malcolm. I had a hand in it.
Yes, sir.
So that the young people would turn against me.
That's right.
Well, Satan, your fraud perpetrating days are all over,
yes,
baby.
Sir. Yes, sir. That's right.
Your days of lying and deceiving the American people is over.
Yes.
Every day that I live from this day on, more and more of America will hear what I really have to say and who I really am.
Yes, sir.
Right.
And those of you who suck the blood of the poor of this nation,
yes, sir,
and rub it in their faces, every day another human being is going to awaken. And when they awaken, the redness in their eye will be the anger of their souls,
yes, sir,
for having been deceived so long.
Right.
And those who see the country slipping out from under them, being taken over by a malicious, greedy, self-interested group,
yes, sir,
will now awaken to take back their country.
Yes, sir.
And it will be because somebody had the courage to stand up and tell the truth.
Yes, sir. Amen.
By God's grace,
yes, sir,
you shall know the truth.
That's right.
Yes, sir.
And the truth shall make you free.
Yes,
so as you leave here tonight, Fresno,
yes,
you make up in your minds that you can change the reality under which you live.
Right.
That if you unite, not only in spirit, but learn how to pool your resources, Fresno, you can dot the landscape with businesses that serve the needs of your people. You got the talent, you got the brain power. This is a marvelous little town with some marvelous little people who, if these marvelous little people will just come together and recognize that each one of you is a gifted soul.
And you don't have to be envious of another human being for anything. Work together for the good of your people. Mexican Americans, let no more animosity be between the black and the brown. Native Americans, let no more animosity be between the black and the red. Poor white people who suffer, rise up and find alliance with those whose cause is common with yours. But remember, black brothers, alliances that are made with others from a position of weakness will cause you to be taken over.
Yes, sir. Right.
So you don't form an alliance with nobody until you form an alliance with each other.
Yes, sir.
You must recognize the need for group unity. Pool your resources and let's go to work like never before. You that are school teachers, recognize what you're teaching these babies. And if it's injurious or harmful, don't engage in the destruction of our children. I urge you to stand up to the school board. Stand up to the teachers' union.
Yes, sir.
Stand up to those who control and destroy the minds of our black babies with this Eurocentric poison.
Yes, sir.
And if we can't change the school system, then let's pull out of it.
Yes, sir.
And let them have their schools and let them teach the crap that they want to teach to their babies, but not destroy ours.
Right.
Open up the churches.
Yes, sir.
Instead of this one day a week preaching on Sunday, let the church once again be the center of all community activity. Open up the church and bring the children in. And those of us that can teach, get in the church and teach the babies in the basement. Teach them in the sanctuary. Because there's nothing more sacred than the children. If the schools won't allow you to teach right to your babies, then take them out. Because if you can't worship God in school, then you don't need to be there. Don't tell me nothing about the separation of church and state. I don't want to hear it. God is the supreme teacher. And if a Jew and a Christian and a Muslim cannot say a silent prayer without trying to influence anybody, and the atheist can just shut his mouth and say nothing, but God must be recognized in everything, otherwise there's no success in anything that you do.
That's right.
If you can't bring God back into school, come out of it yourself. You can do it. All you got to do is say what you want and don't be afraid. And before you know it, they'll back up. They always will back up when people are organized and united. Turn Fresno around. Show Los Angeles, which is the right way to go. Show Sacramento and show San Francisco, which is the right way to go. It should start in a little town like Fresno.
Yes, sir.
Frozen, but now thawing out. Not Fresno no more. Warmed up and ready to go, Fresno. Get up like men and women of God.
Yes.
Look at yourself and see what you're doing to yourself.
Yes.
And if the cigarette is in your mouth, take it out. Throw it down, crush it. It's destroying your health and your well-being. Take the dope out of your mouth, throw it down. Take the crack out your mouth, throw it down. You say, but I can't do it all. Don't tell me what you can't do. Because when God created the heavens and the earth from nothing, he destroyed the impossible. There's nothing impossible with God. But if you come back to God, then you've got power to put all the things down that are destroying your life.
Yes.
Sisters,
No more abortions. You got the right of choice. Choose who you're going to lay down with. And if he don't have a job and don't know where he's going, don't lay down. I don't care how good he looks. If you don't have nothing up top, don't waste your time. Don't even look for pleasure, brother. Pleasure comes after suffering. No man deserves pleasure that won't work for the future of his people. And those of you who don't know how to eat to live, I didn't forget, sister. Stop putting that bad meat in your system.
That's right.
And filling it with so much hormones, pumping up the growth, and you feeding it to your children, running to McDonald's and Wendy's and Burger King. Because you don't want to cook, so you leave it to Sarah Lee and everybody else and don't know what their kitchen looks like and wonder why you're sick all the time. You put your stomach in the hands of the merchants of death.
Yes, sir. Right.
Now your little 9-year-old children got breasts bigger than their mothers.
Right.
Running down the street with a Barbie doll in one hand and a sanitary napkin in the other. And you off busy working, and your fine-looking 9-year-old with the big bosom is out there, and the young men are watching, old men watching. So your daughter's coming up pregnant. It's sad. Clean up what you eat. This is the real house of God. Not the church, brother. That's made of wood and stone. Man's design. This is the architectural genius of God. This is the real house. So don't put garbage in your house. Don't defile the true house of God. I say in conclusion, look at your brother. 60. I look better than some of you young folk. I don't have no big belly falling down on my knees. I ain't showing off. How to eat to live. Look at the shine on my face. Look at how my skin is alive. Come on. You say he must be with Satan. No, why don't you say I'm with God? He said he would give us length of days and abundance of life. I know him. Clean up your act and you don't have to die at 60. Talking about you going to retire. Yeah, I'm 60 now. I'm getting ready to retire. You'll never hear that coming out of my mouth. I will retire when death retires me. But until death retires me, I'm going to be young and strong. When I'm 70, when I'm 80, when I'm 90, I may look better at 90 than I look at 60, because the secret of returning the body to youth is now available. If you could see my skin, it's more beautiful than young men's skin. Tight. Firm, growing new hair on my body, and it ain't gray, it's black. Yeah, I'm telling you the truth. God, I ain't gonna show you, I'm just telling you. So those of you who are 70, a little older than I am, life is not over. Stand up. Brace up. Stop eating the bad foods.
Yes, sir.
Getting just fat, fat.
Yes, sir.
Fat. Killing yourself.
Right.
You won't exercise.
Right.
So your body is just going away from you. You don't use it, you lose it.
Right.
Just think how long you're going to be gone when you go. So why not stay here as long as you can?
Yes, sir.
Stop eating that hog.
That's right.
That nasty pig.
Yes, sir.
Eats all the filth you can give it, then you eat it.
Yes,
it's got these little trichinae worms in it.
Right.
You don't kill it by heating it at 160 degrees. When that worm gets in your system, it starts working in your stomach. Goes to the joints, goes to the spine, up the spine, into the brain. When it gets up there, buddy, it's in you for life. You say, I got arthritis. Arthur haven't got anything to do with it. Pains in all your joints. Clean up your food and you'll find your joints more active. You'll find your body more alive. You'll find you think clearer.
Yes, sir.
Learn how to fast.
Yeah.
You eat too much. Some of you think you'll die if you fasted one day. Try it and see how you feel. You know, when you fast, you get a feeling like you're high.
That's right.
That's right.
I'm high all the time, brothers and sisters. And I don't use drugs.
That's right.
But I stay high.
Yes, sir.
Can't you tell? You see how lit I am? Can't you tell?
Yes,
have you ever fasted for one day?
Mm.
Have you fasted for two? Have you fasted for three?
Yes,
I fasted for three, for seven, for 10, for 12, for 14, for 30, for 40.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Brothers and sisters, you can master this.
That's right.
You can bring it under your control.
Yes, sir.
You can take your sexual desires and control it.
That's right.
That's right.
The power is in your hands.
Yes, sir.
Come on, Fresno.
Come on.
Why not lead California right?
Come on.
I thank you,
for
listening.
Yeah,
thank you for coming out. Thank you, Brother Nellums, for inviting me. Thank you, NAACP. Thank you, Muslims. May God bless you all as I greet you in peace. Assalamu alaikum. Can we have prayer together? Mr. Nellums, I guess the program said remarks, but I don't know that any remarks need to be said. I think we about close this out. We were supposed to have a reception at 9:30. It's now, what time? 11:30. But you know what, Fresno? I couldn't let you go with just a little short talk. I had to feed.
Thank you, sir.
And I'm glad you stayed. Thank you. I will be at the mosque tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock. And from there, I will visit the masjid of the Sunni or Orthodox Muslim community. I hope to meet with one of the rabbis sometime tomorrow before I leave. And I will be at church tomorrow. What's the name of the church?
Fresno Temple.
The Church of God in Christ, Bishop Wilson. Does everybody know where that church is?
Yeah.
Now, what time? 10:45 tomorrow morning. Now look, tomorrow, very special day.
Yes, sir.
Because Farrakhan is going to be in church tomorrow.
Yes,
and those of you... Boy, you're in for a treat if you come out to church tomorrow.
Did you know that I'm Jewish?
That's right.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
That's right.
Come out tomorrow and hear about that. See, Farrakhan said before he closed, I am a Jew. The Muslims are shocked. Look at them. Their mouth fell down. Come on out tomorrow, and I'll tell you how, all according to Scripture, if you go under the right process, you too become a Jew, but different from that is called Jew today. You want to hear about it?
Yes, sir.
See you in the morning. God willing, because between tonight and tomorrow, only God has power over the next moment. So always say, be it the will of God. Or as we say in Arabic, inshallah, if it be the will of Allah, I hope to see you all tomorrow at the mosque or at the church. And then I shall leave this beautiful city. And I'm telling you the truth. I had a good feeling ever since I've been here. And I want to thank the police at the airport for their kindness, the hotel management. I want to thank Ray Appleton for the time that he gave me on his radio show. He treated me with much respect,
yes, sir.
And I appreciate it. I want to thank the members of the press, because after they heard me, they didn't go back and try to destroy me. I saw a change in them, and I appreciate anything that you have said of good. And if you really feel that I'm a bad man, then say it, and I respect that. But I know that you can't be with me for 2 hours or 3 hours and go away saying that man is evil. I know that.
That's right.
So, my thanks to all those who helped make my stay in Fresno enjoyable. And I hope that God will bless me to come back again soon. I'm very grateful to my old friend, long time, brilliant man, Brother Nada Ali, who is a longtime resident of this city, not only a brilliant educator, but one of the most brilliant men that you will probably get a chance to know, Brother Nada Ali. Brother Nada? Yes, sir. So, brothers and sisters, if you don't mind, would you just hold each other's hands? Not in a funny way, but in a... This is not a usual Muslim prayer. But this is not a usual crowd. This is an unusual group. So I want you to hold each other's hand. And we pray that God will link us together in common purpose and common struggle against a common force of evil. And we pray that God will help us to overcome the weakness of self, that we might be made better persons, more worthy of his grace. Let us pray. قل أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم الصراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful. Praise be to Allah, the Lord of the worlds, the Beneficent, the Merciful. Master of the day of judgment, thee alone do we worship, thine aid we seek. Guide us on the straight path, the path of those upon whom you have bestowed favors, not the path of those upon whom wrath is brought down, nor of those who go astray. O Allah, we thank you for this night in Fresno. We thank you for each and every one who came to this auditorium. We thank you for those who wanted to come and had not the means to come. And we pray that the words that you caused us to speak will enter the hearts of those who listened and help us to turn our lives in a better direction. Help us to be more respectful of self and more respectful of others, that we may find the path of true brotherhood and unity, that the kingdom of God may become a reality on this earth in our time. We ask these things of you in your holy and righteous name, for I bear witness that there is no God but you, and I bear witness that Muhammad is your messenger. Amen. Brothers and sisters,
Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar.
That means God is great.
Yes, sir.
Thank you all and go in peace. Salaam alaikum.
Yes, sir.
Hey, brother.
1 minute, 1 minute.
1 minute, please, 1 minute, please.
Hold your seats 1 minute.
Sonia Harmon?